And now to welcome our speaker very warmly today, Professor Mehdi Golshani, who's from the Sharif University in Tehran, and he's there, been there for many years as Professor of Physics. Professor Golshani is also the Director of the Institute for Humanities and Cultural Studies, and he's Chairman of the Faculty of the Philosophy of Science, so one of those people who spans both philosophy and science. And he's published, indeed, a lot in both areas, written a number of books, and he travels and speaks widely in this whole field, particularly of science and religion. So we're really delighted that he's with us today. And he's going to speak on current issues in the science-religion debate in the Islamic world. So, Professor Mehdi, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to be here, especially at the time you are celebrating the 800th anniversary of Cambridge University. And I'm very happy to talk in front of distinguished scholars, some of which I am very happy to see them again, like John. And today I'm going to talk about this issue of science religion. You know, in the Islamic world, there was no idea of science versus religion during the old times. It's a new issue. And it started with the idea of new science, modern science, entering the Islamic world. Before that, science was considered part of religion. So I want to qualify this subject. Let me start with what Quran says. You see, there is plenty of recommendation in the Holy Quran about studying nature, studying the order and harmony in nature, the structure of various things, etc. And in the prophetic tradition, there is plenty of emphasis on getting knowledge, ilm. And knowledge in the Islamic world, in the Islamic sense, in the Quranic sense, has a wide spectrum. It includes everything which is useful for humans. And it has to do, the recommendation, the praiseworthy knowledge consists of two parts. One dealing with the identification and understanding of the creation of God, and the second is to take advantage of the natural resources for the benefit of human being. These two reasons. Now, it is said by the Prophet, go seek knowledge even by going to China. Of course, he then said, go and learn theology in China. So what he meant was knowledge in general. And it is said by Imam Ali, the son-in-law of the Prophet, that you seek knowledge even from polites, which means that they taught knowledge in general sense. Now, the important thing is that this was exactly the understanding of Muslim scientists during the glorious Islamic civilization. Their understanding was that they have to study nature and natural phenomena in order to understand God's creation. This was their main motive. Of course, doing knowledge in its natural way, in other words, by doing experimentation and theoretical work. I quote from Biruni, which was one of the most important scientists of the Islamic civilization era. It says, when a person decides to discriminate between truth and falsehood, he has to study the universe and find out whether it is eternal or created. If somebody thinks that he does not need this kind of knowledge, he is, however, in need of thinking about the laws that govern our world in part or in its entirety. This leads him to know the truth about them and paves the way for knowing the being who directs and controls the universe, and for knowing his attributes. This is, in fact, the kind of truth that God enjoined his knowledgeable servants to search for. And God spoke the truth when he said, and reflect upon the creation of the heavens and the earth, saying, our Lord, you have not created this in vain. This verse, okay. So this means that this first-rate scientist said that the reason behind his work in mineralogy, astronomy, etc., was to find out God's creation. But of course, they didn't bring in from the text in from the holy text in their scientific findings. The only thing which they used was the worldview. The Islamic worldview covered their entire spectrum of seeking knowledge, the whole spectrum. But doing science in its own way, which is experimental search and theoretical work. And this was their way of understanding. It is confirmed by Levy in his book on the social structure of Islam. And he says, apart from a small number of investigators inspired by Greek philosophical ideas, the Muslims who engaged in the pursuit of science did so in order to discover in the wonders of nature the signs or tokens of the glory of God. And this was exactly, you see, the kind of mentality present in the founders of modern science, in Boyle, Newton, etc. Now, after the new science entered the Islamic world, which was in the beginning of 19th century, through Egypt, through India, through Syria, etc., Muslims were at the lowest point of their science, and they were amazed and embarrassed by the kind of developments in the West. So their attitude, they took different attitudes toward modern science. And I classify them in the following way. Some of them rejected modern science as being a foreign element, and they thought that we have to do science in our way based on our holy texts. Others, Muslim intellectuals, some others said that we have to get modern science at the expense of religion, and so they sacrificed religion for science. The third group was those who said that religion and science can benefit from each other, and they can complement each other, and there were various groups, different subgroups. Some Muslim thinkers saw modern science as the continuation of the earlier science, just this kind of science they have had before in the Islamic civilization. Some tried to show that all important scientific findings have come in the Holy Quran. Some scholars advocated the reinterpretation of Islam in the light of findings of modern science. So they talked about a new theology of nature, based on science. Finally, there were some Muslim philosophers who separated the findings of modern science from its philosophical attachment. That's why they praised the attempt of Western scientists for the discovery of the secrets of nature. They warned against merely empiricistic and materialistic interpretation of scientific findings and recommended that scientific knowledge should be integrated into a metaphysical framework consistent with the Islamic worldview. Now we come to the contemporary scene. In the contemporary scene, that there is a problem of science versus religion in the West, there is also this kind of classification in the Islamic world, and I'll just enumerate them. Some scholars consider religion and science as two independent spheres of human activity, one dealing with individual aspects of human life, like religion, the other one with the social aspects of human life, science, or dealing with different kind of questions, why questions in religion and how questions in science. So these consider them separate, and they see no conflict. The conflict comes when one of these oversteps into the domain of the other one. Some intellectuals consider science and religion in conflict. Of course, these are in minority. Some of them take religion and put aside science. Some of them take science and forget about religion. This is a minority group in the Islamic world. Some scholars believe that science and religion are compatible And in fact, there could be fruitful interaction between them. These scholars may be categorized in the following way. Some scholars think that there are some common grounds between science and religion, and in these areas they can benefit from each other, presenting a richer perspective about the case. Some scholars try to harmonize the Quran with science, tries to use scientific knowledge in order to interpret the Quran. Then there is another group, which is very popular throughout the whole Islamic world. This group tries to find the root of modern scientific findings in the Holy Quran. Says that if science finds, for example, this fact, the root has been there in that verse and that verse, etc. So this group are, this kind of mentality is very popular in the Islamic world. Then we come to the last group, which are philosophers or scientists with philosophical mentality. And they say that both science and religion have ontological and epistemological claims about the same world. And we have to put our understanding of the universe within one unifying frame, for example, our religious worldview. In their view, scientific activity consists of two parts. First, a collection of facts, experimental results. Second, is the theoretical work plus interpretation of the theories. They say that it's in this part that various philosophical, psychological, sociological assumptions creep in, and this is what makes difference between the conclusions of a theist plus scientist or an atheist plus scientist. So, for example, Ernan McMullin says that Newton's theistic worldview affected his theorizing at all levels. Newton could not have developed his theories without metaphysical principles of some sort. There had to be decisions about where to make the cuts in nature, about where to seek causal agency, about what should count as explanation, etc. So he believes that metaphysical assumptions and the worldview affected Newton's mentality at all levels of his science major. Okay. Now I come to the present problems, which are, as far as the science-religion interface is concerned, which are discussed throughout the Islamic world. I have found five or six problems, which are currently being debated and talked about. The first one is God and creation. The problem of creation has been always associated with God and the creation being done by God, etc. Before Renaissance, it was used as a premise in the philosophical arguments. And in recent centuries, especially during 20th century, has been used as a scientific proof for the existence of God. Now, as far as the Islamic world is concerned, there have been a couple of schools as far as creation is concerned, prevalent in the Islamic world. First, there were theologians. Theologians taught that there has to be the beginning of time where God created the whole universe. There has to be a temporal beginning for the universe. And they said that if the universe is eternal, then this means that God's it is equal to God. So they could not accept at any price the atemporality of the world. This was the mentality of theologians. Of course, not all theologians believe this way. Some of the later theologians have the same view as philosophers that I'm going to mention. Most of the earlier philosophers in the Islamic world, Avicenna, Farabi, etc., believe that there is no temporal beginning to the world. They thought that if there is a temporal beginning, it means that there hasn't been
God's effusion for a while, I mean, for a long time, and there is an interruption in God's effusion. So they could not accept the world to have a temporal beginning. But they believed that there is an ontological dependence on the part of creatures on God. This was their mentality. Four philosophers, say, before Renaissance. During the time of Renaissance, an important philosopher came whose views are not that much reflected in some of the English-speaking countries. It's most reflected in France, for example. Recently, it is also some of his views as being echoed here in UK and in America, etc. It was Mulla Sadra. Mulla Sadra said that so far philosophers were saying that only accidents have motion. Now I'm saying that the substance by itself has motion. So everything is in development, in motion. And he said that, in fact, everything is being created at every instant. So there is a recreation, a constant recreation of the world. The matter of universe at this moment receives an existence from God the next moment, etc. Of course, Muslim mystics also believe in continuous creation, but with a different way of saying it. They said that at every moment the world vanishes and then it is given an existence by God. So in their view, there is at every moment an undressing and then there is a dressing of existence. Okay, this has been the views of Muslim philosophers and theologians. As far as the modern scientists are concerned, those who have studied modern science and are not familiar with philosophical works, they say the same kind of things which is being said here in the West. But those who have actually gone through philosophy, etc., they have the same mentality as one of these schools that I described. And you can see their views in different books and conferences, etc. So as far as creation is concerned, there is almost the same kind of views which is presently prevalent here as in the Islamic world. Elsewhere I have shown in detail the parallels between what some of the modern theologians and philosophers, etc., are saying in the Christian world. There are parallels to what Muslim theologians or philosophers said earlier. For example, William Craig is using the theologians' argument for it that if there is a beginning of time, beginning for time, then there needs to be a creator, a cause for it. So this is the first problem, the problem of creation. Muslim philosophers' argument was based on God's absolute effulgency and beneficency. It is not acceptable to think of God's emanation and beneficence as terminating at a definite instant. According to this philosopher, creation simply means complete dependence of everything on God. Now we come to Darwinian evolution. Okay, as far as the Darwinian evolution is concerned, there is a mixed reaction to it. Many scholars, especially some of the theologians, reject Darwinian evolution in its totality. However, there are philosophers and theologians that accept part of Darwinian Darwinian idea of evolution, and that's the fact that the fixity of a species, that it is not necessary that a species being fixed, there could have been development of a species, etc. But they say, when you say that it went through natural selection, and you say there wasn't anything beyond that, here they separate. They said to biologists, you have discovered the mechanism of something. But finding the mechanism of something doesn't mean that it doesn't have an inventor. So here they separate. And of course, about the problems of rooting, for example, morality in evolution, etc., they completely reject it. So there is not a total rejection of evolutionism in the Islamic world. Most of the philosophical jargon which is attached to Darwinism is rejected. Not the main idea of fixity of a species. As they said, it could be the development of a species. And this is not new. Even say, I think it was 44 years after Darwin's book that the first book in Islamic world appeared. And said, okay, if there is not a if there is a development of a species, that's all right. It is consistent with monotheism. So they make this distinction between the main part of Darwin's idea and the attachment that it found later on. The third problem is science and technology and ethical issues. There is no doubt that science and technology have brought a lot of blessings for human beings. But on the other hand, there is no doubt that a lot of harm to human beings has been done and to the environment through the results of misusing science and technology. For that reason, there has been a conscious rising in this both Islamic world and the Christian world that we have to do something about it. And I think religion is the best way of remedying this kind of thing. For example, in the Holy Quran, it is said, do not make corruption in the earth. All of these facilities that God has given to you, you have to use it for the benefit of mankind. Human beings and the facilities that are given, I mean human beings basically, are part of the cosmic order. They are not the whole cosmic order, and they are not supposed to disturb the cosmic order. So I think both in the Islamic world and in the Christian world, there is a sense of raising and strengthening the moral aspects of the issues dealing with science and technology. There has to be a moral code in all of the fields of science. You are not supposed to misuse science for any kind of thing. In fact, in all three monotheistic religions, humankind is part of a wider cosmic order that plans for the scientific progress and technological innovations are supposed to be harmonious with this cosmic order. Then we come to genetic manipulations. There has been a lot of advancements in the field of genetics, and a lot of good can come from it. But a lot of harm can come also from it. So there has to be a lot of watching on the subject, studying it thoroughly before doing something. For example, if you consider the problem of cloning, they say that there is three possible damages for cloning. This has to do destroying the dignity of human life, affecting the family system that could lead to legal and ethical dilemmas. Cloning could lead to some unpredictable, incurable problems as we do not have enough information about possible consequences of the new discoveries. In the Islamic world, there has been difference of opinion throughout the whole Islamic world. Differences of opinion about cloning. A lot of important ulama admitted, but there is a unanimous voice that the gene manipulation experiments require extraordinary caution and should not proceed irresponsibly. This is what they are unanimous. But If you go to different Islamic countries, etc., you see different verdicts. But they are all saying that we have to do after we have got information about it. The Holy Quran says, don't do something that you don't know about it. Or if you think you have to find, you have to do little by little before you you come into a very heavy danger. The fifth one is Islamic or religious or theistic science. After Muslim countries saw that they putting religion aside or taking it, and importantly, doesn't solve their problems, there has been a lot of voice throughout the whole Islamic world for Islamic science, or theistic science, or religious science. And here it comes into two completely different versions. The first group say that we have to start a new science, an Islamic science, we have to start from the beginning. Everything based on the Quran and the prophetic tradition. These kind of people are present throughout the Islamic world, but they are not majority. Those who talk about Islamic science or religious science, or I prefer to call it theistic science, usually mean the following. They say that science consists of two parts. First part is experimentation and collecting facts. This is the same. It could be done everywhere similarly. There is no difference. But when it comes to the matter of theorizing, choosing between theories and interpretations, then there comes a lot of difference. Because one can prove, and I have shown in my book From Physics to Metaphysics, that a lot of things, and various people here have done similarly, that various things that are done in the name of science is really not science proper. It is philosophy added to science. It really attaching a definite philosophical school to your science. This is the kind of thing which is happening. And this is the kind of thing which causes problem. They say that the methodology of science is okay. You have to do the experiments. You have to do theorizing. In fact, in the Quran it is said, go around the earth and find out how he started creation. Reflect on how he started creation. Which means that experimentation and theoretical work. So they don't deny that there has to be experimentation and theoretical work, and they don't see any limit to it. You should go as much as you can physically. But when you bring in, that's what they say, when you bring in metaphysical assumptions, supra-scientific assumptions, then if you don't have any experimental knowledge available, you are not supposed to go beyond the worldview of your religion. In other words, what they say? They said that at the theoretical level, it would avoid the Islamic science or religious science or theistic science. At the theoretical level, it would avoid generalizations that are not verifiable by experiment, but are against established metaphysical principles of religion. In other words, they say that metaphysical principles come in when you don't have access to experiment. Also, religious science makes a difference at the practical level. It prevents you to do any kind of thing that could lead to destruction of environment, destruction of human beings, etc. So, when you talk about religious science, it doesn't mean that you are doing in this version. When you are talking about religious science, it doesn't mean that you are doing science in a different way. No, you do science in the same way as it is usually done. But when you generalize, when you extrapolate, it is the place that you have to be watchful. For example, if you read Fred Hoyle's Cosmology, there he says that very clearly, explicitly, that the reason that he prefers steady state theory because it avoids any metaphysical commitment. That's exactly what he says. And a lot of things are being done in the same way. In fact, as far as the theory level is concerned, when you are dealing with the problems of origin, either the origin of human beings or the origin of the universe, when you are dealing with problems of origin, where you are dealing with theories which are most fundamental, at the fundamental level, here is where the theistic science makes the difference. Otherwise, at the regular level of the scientific activity, it doesn't make any, it's not different from the regular science. Thank you very much.
Right, thank you very much, Mehdi. Well, we've got some good time for questions and discussion. I'm sure there's plenty of questions.
I'm going to submit you the written for, but I summarized it in order to have time for
that's excellent. No, we enjoy always having a good time of discussion. So it's really over to you. I'm going to kick off, actually, just to get the ball rolling. As in the response to Darwinian evolution, one thing you didn't focus on particularly was human evolution. My understanding is that's often the sticking point in the Islamic world.
That's a good question.
People were happy
The point is that it is very clear in Islam, and all agree on it, because it is mentioned explicitly in the Quran, that human beings have a spirit which other animals do not share it. In other words, human consciousness is completely different from what is in the animals. It is very explicit in the Quran, and there is no difference of opinion about it. So this is something that, that was a good question. I was going to say it, yes.
I had a question over here.
Yes, could you please give an example for the idea that you presented at the end, that science could profit from religious metaphysical beliefs, because I can imagine, or I find it obvious that science needs to theorize by using metaphysical beliefs about what kind of objects exist in the world and how they're connected and everything. But how do you have an example a religious metaphysical belief coming into play in theorizing in science?
Yes, I can give you a very good example. You see, there this problem of multiverse, many universes, consider this. This was in one context, not in the oldest context was in the quantum mechanics, many worlds interpretation, but in cosmology, was brought up on as the problem of fine-tuning of the natural constants was brought in. There is a fine-tuning between various forces of nature. Now, you have to explain this. Theists say that this is done by God. The fine-tuning that led to the appearance of human beings, etc., it is very fine-tuned. In other words, you have seen it. If you change it a little bit, the ratio between one force and the strength of one force to the other, the balance is going to change, and we could have not reached this stage. Now, religious scientists say that this could have been done by God, the fine-tuning. Now, what others are doing? Those who are looking for multiverse idea, think they say that if we bring in billions and billions of universes, then there is a chance that this in one of them there could be this specific ratios that we see. But the point is this. The idea of multiverse is consistent with the creation by God. And in fact, among the Muslim scholars, it was a very, very old issue because it started with the Quran, that he is the God of many worlds. And they don't see any problem with the idea of having many worlds. Now, you could interpret fine-tuning that way, or you could interpret it this way. So it's up to you. If you are, anyhow, when you are bringing the problem of many universes, say if you go to a string theory which says there are 10 to the 500 solutions, in other words, 10 to the 500 universes, you are really assuming infinitely many universes being parallel to each other, not detectable. Here you are making a very strong metaphysical assumption. On the other hand, in religion, you say the Almighty God has given this. That's very easy because of his omnipotence, omniscience, etc. Yeah, it has been very easy for him. So both of them are metaphysical answers to the problem of fine-tuning. So is the problem of, for example, life. So is the problem of life. You could start by saying that, okay, human life, human consciousness, etc., it's an emergent property. But you are only saying words. You haven't solved the problem. You have pushed the problem back. In the religious case, in Christianity and Islam, you bring in the problem of soul and explain the thing. So, and both of them are metaphysical. When you say, in the first case that you say emergent properties and you are taking it physical, you are not saying really what emergent has, what emergence means. Only, it's like this, that some scientists had written a book and had called particles which we are dealing with in quantum mechanics, quantum particles. Another physicist answered very quickly, by giving a name you cannot solve a problem. You cannot say what the quantum particle is. So this is exactly the case.
Okay, it's a question right over there. Yes, Lisa. Yes.
Thank you very much. I would like to know your thoughts on the idea that Islamic science during Islamic civilization had an element of sacred, which is not present in the Western tradition since Renaissance. This idea that man consists of this is spiritual being as well as just material.
You see, the problem is that science during the Islamic civilization era was considered sacred. Science, mathematics, biology, etc. Because it was taught that it is a way, your way to God. That's the way. It was sacred. Because sacred originally means God. But anything that brings you close to God has a degree of sacredness. So it was considered sacred. Scientific activity was taught as a worship, a kind of worship, like the prayer that you do, etc. This was taught a kind of worship, of course, in its own way, which is experimentation, theoretical work, intuition, etc.
Yes, John.
Just a comment, really. As I listened to the very interesting talk, I was continually struck by how similar the Christian approach and the Islamic approach is to the sort of problems you've discussed, and I'm sure a Jewish person would say the same
from
a point of view. So there is a good deal of unanimity among the Abrahamic faiths here that we need to
explore. Yes. In fact, I tell you that in Berlin at SSQ that you were present and I was there, one day I gave a presentation and a Jewish scholar was to criticize my presentation. And in fact, he said, I don't have anything to add to it. I exactly
Interesting. Yeah. Yes. Please.
Did I understand you to say that you accept that man has evolved, most recently from the higher apes, and that the difference between us and those higher apes is that we have, in some way, a soul or a spirit which they don't have? And if that is the case, does the Islamic, or do the Islamic scholars care to put a date when this might have happened in the evolutionary sequence? And
no.
As a separate question, is every Islamic child born with a spirit, or is it implanted somehow during the development of the fetus?
Now, you see, first of all, as far as the spirit is concerned, you see, first of all, as far as their mentality is concerned, you see, they say that the development of a species is possible. They don't deny it. They say that definitely. Because as far as I can understand myself, not being a biologist, but reading their thing, not everything is said in the evolution, in the field of evolution. Biology is not a finished business yet. And I think what Charles Townes was recommending was that he said, I hope that someday biologists hit a break wall so that they learn a little bit of humility from the way physicists have learned. So I said that is a, they consider it a possibility that it is could be. What they want to say is that even it has gone there, then there is a difference. At a moment, the, first of all, even the spirit, soul, there is a school of philosophy in Islam that says it started with a material aspect, the spirit. At a certain level, it becomes immaterial. This is Mullah Sadra's philosophy that says the spirit, human spirit, starts with matter and develops into immaterial. And anyhow, the Quranic saying is that as far as human beings are concerned, we have given them something extra. This is the thing which is explicit.
Can I just follow up so I understand it? Something extra comes in at birth then? Is that ensoulment in a sort of sense in which some Christians think?
Well, God says that at a definite, and they say, for example, 40 days or something, different ideas. At a definite moment, this is given to human beings. But God says, I offer them a special creation. A special creation of mine. That's what he says.
Yes, question over here. Yes, please. Yes.
Thank you very much. I wanted to ask to what extent post-scientific revolution Western philosophy has been much read and influential. Descartes through Kant.
Well, let me talk about philosophy. As far as my country, Iran, is concerned, has been a country of philosophy. Because when philosophy in the Islamic world died after, say, 800, etc., after Prophet's death, about 800 after Prophet, it continued in Iran, philosophy. So as far as there is concerned, most of the important classic texts in philosophy has been translated, commented on, and is being compared. So they are very well versed in the Western philosophy and also in comparative aspects of them. The rest of the world, in some of the countries, like for example, Egypt is partly there, in Turkey recently is partly there, in Pakistan and India is partly there, in Saudi Arabia there is no philosophy, etc. So it's different really. It's very different.
Yes.
Thank you. You made the point that since the Renaissance, much damage seems to be done by the misuse of science. And you followed that up to say that science is okay as long as it doesn't go too far into experimentation, I believe.
No.
Am I wrong about that?
No. See.
Yeah. Okay, well, the implication was that there was a point where science had to stop. And my question would be, is who would say science has got to stop, and where would it stop?
Well, you see, I think a lot of things which is done by science could be avoided. A lot of weapons that were made could have not been made. I mean, this is made, and in fact, the United Nations book says 25%. Some of the other articles gave 50% of the scientists and engineers in the West are somehow involved with making weaponry, etc. So it is, I am not saying to stop science at anywhere, except when you are definite that it could be misused. In this kind of thing which has been used, it has been misused. It was clear from the beginning that it is going to be too misused. For whom are you make biological weapons? You see, mostly are the innocent which are being harmed.
I think we would all agree with you about that. My point is how does Islam or whatever get to a point where somebody is saying no to this? Because there is always an argument of somebody has got of why you do it.
No, as so far as it's not clear, it's clear for you that there is no harm, you should do it. When it is clear. When it is not clear, you should go slowly and responsibly to find out little by little. You know the way, for example, in U.S. then, that 17-member committee that they had for these genetic manipulations, etc., they said up to year so-and-so, you are supposed to stop, not to do that kind of thing, and after that they are going to give their verdict. What I'm saying is that if they are suspicious of some harmful effects to human beings or to the environment, they have to avoid it. If they are sure about it, they have to avoid it. If they are not sure, they have to go little by little so that they become, it becomes clear this way or that way.
I look forward to the day when it stops.
Good. Yes, a question out from here. Yes, please. Yes.
You said something wonderful about the pursuit of science and mathematics as a sacred occupation, which I thoroughly agree with. But that idea has been lost in the West. May I ask two related questions? Is the idea of the sacredness of science and mathematics still strong in Islam? And two, can Islamist scholars point to a moment in Western culture and philosophy when this idea was lost? I would point to St. Albert the Great, 12th century, whose writings show that, argue that science and reason and religion are just part of a continuous spectrum.
That's
and that idea seems to have been lost in the West.
That's true. That's true. I think up to the time of Newton, it was okay. Next 100 years after that, they thought that science can solve everything. I think, and the appearance of certain philosophers. You know, I think the most of the harm was done when physics, metaphysics and philosophy was separated from science. Most of the, and then some specific philosophies, like positivistic philosophy, etc., entered in. That they bounded everything to sensual facts, things which come from sense. When they did that, then the world became materialistic. Schumacher has a very nice sentence. He says that the whole thing that was brought to the West was because it changed from science for understanding to science for manipulation. I think this is a very good summary. It was science for understanding. I didn't read it here, but in my article is there. Heisenberg quotes Kepler. That says, he didn't do science for benefit, for any kind of worldly benefits. He just did it to understand the creation of God. There is no doubt that the mentality of scientists have changed. And there is no doubt that this has to change again. There was a very, very, very nice article recently by Nikolai Maxwell here that says that there has to be a revolution in the philosophy of science. I really recommend you. I don't know, I remember exactly the title, but it's a recent one. It's a very good recommendation that you have to generalize your scope, then all of these problems become solved.
Can I pick you up on the first part of that question, which was actually, I mean, in your context, in your Islamic context, I mean, do you feel that most scientists and mathematicians are still operating within the sense of the sacredness?
No,
or is that also lost?
No.
That's been lost.
That's
as well.
Lost, too. Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. Lost, too, definitely. Okay. Yes, yes.
I
yes.
See. Okay.
A minority still are pursuing it very, very anxiously and doing it, but it's a minority.
Mm-hmm. Can I follow that? Would you say that, I mean, in the Iranian context, that most science is sort of carried out within a quite separate, secularized context?
Yes,
it is.
It is. Okay. It is. Now that we have, in our departments of philosophy, of science, etc., we bring in these special philosophical ideas that they have to be watchful for.
Thank you. Yes, question.
I have a question that relates to that. I wonder if you could give us a feel as to whether the man in the street in Iran is aware of these discussions. I mean, are they in the features pages of the newspapers or whatever?
Man in the street, no, but the students, yes, because these problems are mentioned in the newspapers. What Dawkins says or what that philosopher says, they are reflected. So the students, yes, they are very well aware of these discussions.
Mm-hmm.
The man in the street, no.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, there's a question in the back row there, yes.
I just would like to ask you, and if you could maybe explain to the others. Do you think interesting that the principles that were applied in extracting hadith, prophetic sayings, can those principles of justifying the character of the man who transmits an information as much as what he transmits, do you think that that can be applicable in today's science when references are taken very casually and science is based on very loose foundations of reference or previous work done, and that you have a whole story built up on a very loose foundation?
Well, I'm not sure if I understood very well, but if I have got the idea right, your idea right, the point is that the students and a lot of faculty really are not aware of the heavy burden of philosophical assumptions which is entered into their science. They are not aware. If they become aware, their mentality is going to change. Yes.
Yes, Katie.
Yes.
It's the concept that in the past, as a scientist, that you would also need to be quite an evolved human being. Like, you'd have to be spiritually well-versed, you'd have to be of a good moral character to become a scientist. And I think that what this lady was trying to say is that still, what does that now mean, that we live in a world where with modern science, we have the modern scientific social structure where references are very poor for people, it doesn't seem to matter too much whether people have done what they say they've done. What do you think is the impact?
Well, I think the thing that has to be done at the universities throughout the world is that when people are learning science, they are only dealing with their own specialty as if the whole world is their specialty. I think their scope has to be changed. They have to get a wider, even though they specialize in a definite field, they have to get a wider scope, learn about philosophy, morality, etc. If this is done, the picture is going to change. Now the students, I'm seeing in my country and I'm seeing it elsewhere, they are only concerned with their own specialty and or their own results, as if there is nothing else existing in the world.
Thank you. Yes, question.
Thank you for your talk. How do scientists in the Islamic world approach the formation of the Quran itself as a reliable source? Because a lot of, so I don't mean to kind of this shaky ground. I don't mean to say anything controversial, but for a scientist, it may in many ways be quite difficult to accept the whole idea of Muhammad receiving the word of God and all of that. How is that married, the kind of authority of the Quranic verse, even though it seems in many ways quite unscientific?
Well, if you base your whole information on science, obviously there is no room for that kind of thing. So those people who are only concerned with science, they don't accept those kind of things. Quran means, or for example, the New Testament means for people something when they believe that there is more to the world than what science says. Then they say that there are, then they can believe that there are extra things. Once you believe that the whole world consists of what science says, then there is no room for there. But you have to understand that at this very moment, science gives you information only about 5% of the matter of the world. 95%, we don't know what it is made of.
Okay, question in the back, yes.
Professor Golshani, I have a question related to, you mentioned Mullah Sadra and many other, Bayrouni also, they're philosophers. I'm intrigued by how someone like Mullah Sadr, for example, or Al-Bayrouni, or Ibn Sina, to what extent does... You talked about how science deals with the physical world, and then there's a level of metaphysical world. But I'm intrigued by how one's internalization of certain metaphysical frameworks through a hermeneutical process yields and unveils or opens up possibilities of seeing things or understanding the universe in ways that one cooped up in a very scientific, physical way of looking at the world cannot. The point I'm trying to make is, to what extent does the metaphysical framework of Tawheed, for example, or the metaphysical framework of a hierarchy of being yield certain possibilities or visions of understandings that opens up possibilities for science?
Well, you see, what is said in the Quran and also in Christianity, etc., and all of the Abrahamic religions, is that you are given this character of being able to understand the world. You are given this characteristic of being able to understand the world. But you cannot prove by science that you can do this kind of thing. You are doing it as if you are intrinsically, you know it is right. But you cannot prove it. There are many things in science you do that you cannot prove it. And you are only doing it on the basis of faith. You prove that the same laws that hold here are holding in sun, for example, or in galaxy X, etc. On what basis are you doing? The only channel available to you is light. How do you know there are no other channels? How do you know that there are only these four forces? I mean, our information is too little to claim a big claim on the basis of science. And if you compare your knowledge now, for example, with 50 years ago, it's completely revised. You know about some things that you didn't know anything about, say, 50 years ago. So the knowledge, as we are seeing and witnessing in the last couple of hundred years, has been increasing. And there is nothing to prove that we have reached a definite limit. And in fact, we have some hints that you can never say this is the end of it. If you look at Gödel's theorem, for example, you can never claim that the theory is complete. So, I mean, there is very little claim that you can make on the basis of science. And especially, if you go into one of the fields of science, say cosmology or quantum mechanics, etc., see how many interpretations are there. Even within the orthodox interpretation of quantum mechanics, see how many subclasses are there. There is no conclusive idea, and some very important big questions are left there. So how could we claim that we can answer things on the basis of science?
Good. Well, I think that's a very good point probably in which to finish. And we've worked, Professor Golshani, very hard indeed. So I think we want to thank you very much for an interesting seminar.
And also in Christianity, etc.